إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن سيدنا وحبيبنا مولانا سيدنا محمد عبده ورسوله خير نبي اجتباه وهدى للعالمين أرسله الله بدين الحق ليظهر على دين كله ولو كره الكافرون اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وأزواجه وذريته وأصحابه وتابعين وتابعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين أما بعد عباد الله أذكركم وإياي بتقوى الله سبحانه وتعالى وذكركم بقوله سبحانه وتعالى حيث يقول في القرآن الكريم يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون وذكركم وإياي بحفظ القرآن الكريم وسنة سيدنا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته الحمد لله that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us this opportunity. And the opportunities that we could mention, or are numerous that we could mention, but first and foremost, that He gave us the opportunity to return back to Him. That there are many who did not wake up this morning, did not have the opportunity for one more fajr, did not have the opportunity for reading Surah Al-Kahf one more time, did not have the opportunities that we've been afforded on this day. So first and foremost, we should praise and thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the gift of life. For the gift of life that we've been granted this day, subhanahu wa ta'ala, only through His infinite mercy. I want to speak today about something that all of us are dealing with. The issue is a commodity that we are all feeling is being taken from us, and that is time. But I want to speak about it in a way that, inshallah ta'ala, how we can maximize our time, how we can take benefit. And I want to talk about just some things that we can do that take a short time during our day. A lot of times we think that returning back to our states of spirituality or increasing our states of spirituality require a long process. But as Imam Zaid always used to tell us in Damascus, that the 1,000-mile journey begins with the first step. So rather than thinking about it, because that's easy then for Shaytan to come and say that we don't have time. We don't have time to, you know, implement these things in our lives, but inshallah ta'ala we'll hear a few things that can change us in a short period of time each day if we commit ourselves to that. So inshallah ta'ala we'll go through a list, inshallah ta'ala, of a few things, and if we're already doing some of these things that are on the list, we can adopt other things. And if we are doing some of them, we can enhance the things that we're doing to make them even better, inshallah ta'ala. So the first thing that we can do, the Prophet ﷺ said to Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said to Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu, or Abu Huraira said, Osini khalili bi thalath, that my khalil, my beloved, the Prophet ﷺ, he gave me sound counsel in three things. He said, an usum thalatha ayyam fi shahr, wa usalli raka'atay duha, wa an usalli witr qabla anam. He said that my Habib, that the Khalil, Mustafa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he gave me good counsel in three things. Inshallah ta'ala, I want to just mention one of them. The first one he said though that I should fast 3 days in each month. If we're already doing that, may Allah give us tawfiq. If we're not, may Allah give us strength, inshallah. But the second one is I want to mention, he said, an usalli raka'atay duha, that he gave me good counsel to pray two raka'ats of duha. So this is what I'm talking about 10 minutes in each day. Alhamdulillah, through the fadl, the grace, and the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I just returned back from Umrah. And it was the second time that I've been able to co-lead this trip that we went with And we had a mixture of students, about 80 of us in the group. Majority of them were students from NYU and from Yale and from other schools on the East Coast. And we had adults as well too. The reason why I want to mention this is because we get excited about making an Umrah. And we should, rightfully so. Because the Umrah, as we know, is an expiation of sins from the year, from the time that you make the Umrah until the next time you make the Umrah, it's an expiation of sins. But the Prophet ﷺ has said that to make two raka'at of duha is to have a hajj and a umrah maqbool. Two raka'at. To make the wudu and to pray two raka'at. And to show you how impactful this is, we had a man on our trip that was in his 50s. He said, I never heard of this before. And then he came back at the end of the trip and was crying. And he said, do you know the gift that you have given me? Do you know the gift that you have given me? So this is what I talked about. We're all compressed for time. All of us can talk about how packed our schedule are. And we can pull out our iPads right now and lift up our schedules. And we'll talk about getting you over my house for some food. But it'll have to be in 2 weeks because we're all so busy. But what about committing, as I said, that 10 minutes in a day for something? Something that is not a part of our life right now that is going to be everlasting and remain with us for eternity. And this is what one of my teachers said when I was leaving Damascus. He reminded me of the line of Imam Shafi'i who said, addressing his nafs, he said, Ya nafsi, anti turidina al-mu'jizat, wallahu la yuridu minki illa al-istiqama. That, oh nafs, he said to his nafs, that you want to see amazing things, you want to see mu'jizat, you want to see miracles. But Allah is only desirous of you that you remain upright and steadfast on your deen. So he said to me, he said, Dawood, I give you this advice when you return back. He said, you want to know what a miracle is? He said, a miracle is that you take a blameworthy trait, such as lying or backbiting, and you remove it from your character. And you replace it with a praiseworthy trait, and you remain on that until you die. He said, that is a mu'jizah. That is a miracle. Because now that will remain with you for eternity. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us the strength to see these things, the barakah, the blessing, and His giving in two raka'at of duha. So that we meet Him, we see how many hajj we have that are maqbool, and how many umrah that we have that are maqbool. Why? Because of two raka'at that we pray each day. From after the tulu', from after the rising of the sun until the zawab. May Allah give us tawfiq inshaAllah. As we know, alhamdulillah, it is nothing new to this community. Alhamdulillah, may Allah give us tawfiq. This other point I want to mention about salawat on the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And we could give multiple khutbas, not just one, but multiple, just on the fadal of this. But I want to share with you a story of one of the scholars, subhanAllah. To me, of what is the practical reality as well as the spiritual reality of the salawat on the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We know this, that one salah alayhi marra sallallahu alayhi ashra. And then there was another hadith that we were reading when we were in Medina, وَمَنْ صَلَى عَلَيْهِ عَشْرَ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ مِيَّةٍ وَمَنْ صَلَى عَلَيْهِ مِيَّةٍ صَلَى عَلَيْهِ أَلْفٍ وَمَنْ صَلَى عَلَيْهِ أَلْفٍ مَرَّةٍ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ أَلْفٍ مِيَّةٍ. And the hadith continues, that the one who gives salutations upon me of peace and blessings, Allah sends peace and blessings upon that person 10 times. And the one who does it on me 10 times, Allah sends it on him 100. And the one who does it on me 100, Allah sends it on him 1,000. The one who does it on me 1,000, Allah sends it on him 100,000. And the one that who sends it on me 100,000 times, then Allah makes it haram for his body to touch the fire. Sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. So we can talk about this and talk about this, but here's a practical reality. One of the great scholars was traveling. And he wanted to make it from one city to a second city before nightfall, because there were certain animals and other things that he wanted to ensure his well-being during the night. But he didn't make it. He didn't make it to that second city, so he said, I'm going to remain here for the night. And he was a bit concerned for his well-being. So he remembered, Man salla alayhi marra, sallallahu alayhi ashra. The one who sends salutations upon me, then Allah will send salutations upon him 10 times. So he said, I spent my entire night, Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina Muhammad. Because I wanted that rahmah, I wanted that security, I wanted that sakina to descend upon me. So he said that he spent his night sending salutations of the Prophet. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he said he remained in this state until the Fajr came. And then when the Fajr came, he prayed his Fajr, he prayed his Duha, and then he carried on. And he said, I felt that I had strength to continue on even though without sleeping. And I felt safe the entire night from anything that could have afflicted me, from the salawat. And he said, as I began to make my way forward, I began to now continue my journey to this other town, I walked by a bush. And when I passed by that bush, I heard something rustle, and I became scared, and I jumped. And then a little quail, a little bird, walked out from the bush. So what's the importance of mentioning that? He said to himself, blaming his nafs, he said, you spent the whole night relying upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and you felt no fear, and you felt contented, and you felt safe, and you felt secure. You felt protected by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As soon as the sun rose, you left Allah and depended on your nafs, and Allah sent a little bird and put fear in your heart. Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam. So the practical reality of it. We have the spiritual reality of it, but there's also a practical reality of it. May Allah give us an understanding of this at a deeper meaning. So again, in continuing with this, something else that we can do, very simple, just saying Subhanallah. Just saying Subhanallah. The Prophet ﷺ asked the Sahaba that who amongst you is desirous to have 1,000 hasanat in a day? They said, Ya Rasulullah, this is difficult to achieve. He said, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, just qul Subhanallah. Say Subhanallah. How about the time and our comings and goings? Just something so simple, right? But this is now to be mindful. And things are known by their opposites. Because if we're not mindful, then shaitan is running us through other things in our head. But as our coming and going, whether we're on the train or on the car, wherever we are, just Subhanallah. 1,000 hasanat for once. Umar radiallahu anhu, he said that if you have one accepted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this is sufficient for you in the akhirah. This is the generosity. Right? This is the generosity of being mindful of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then we have another hadith in terms of the dhikr, where the Prophet said, kalimatani khafifatani khafifatani ala lisani faqilatani inda al-mizani habibatani inda al-rahmani Subhanallah wa bihamdi, Subhanallah al-Azim. The Prophet ﷺ said two words. Faqeel al-afwan, khafifatani ala lisani. It's light on the tongue, it's easy to say. Walakin, faqeelatani inda al-mizan. That it's heavy on the scale. How many of us need our scales to be heavy on that day when we stand in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Kalimatani, khafifatani ala lisani, faqilatani inda al-mizani. Heavy on the scale in that day. And not only that it continues, that not only is it going to be heavy on your scale, but it's habibatani inda al-rahman. It's beloved by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So now as I'm commuting, as I'm back and forth, Subhanallah wa bihamdi, Subhanallah al-Azim, what is happening now? My scale is becoming heavy on Yawm al-Qiyamah. What is happening now? I am doing something that is pleasing, that is beloved by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Very quickly. And even if we can stop for a moment to give pause, right? Because we're moving at breakneck speed all the time, but just to give pause, to have intentionality to say, I'm going to sit for 10 minutes out of a day. Let's discipline ourselves with that. That's the juhud that we're after. Man jadda wajjada. That the one who exerts themselves, that they are the ones that will find these openings, the rahmah, the mercy from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Just take 10 minutes. When the family is asleep, or before they've woken up, just 10 minutes as guarded to say subhanallah wa bihamdi subhanal azim. With a presence of heart. And try not to lose it. Regardless of what situation we are, whether we are traveling, whether we are at home, right? To stay on that, because going back to what Imam Shafi'i said, Wallahu la yuridu minki ila al-istiqamah. That Allah is not desirous of you except for that you are steadfast. Right? So continuing in this, regardless of what our situation is, something that will be heavy in our scale, and something that is beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is something here, this point that I'll mention here. Alhamdulillah, for those of us who are parents, but playing with our children, spending some time, dedicating time with our children. Because let's look at the prophetic example, sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam, that the best of creation, and we like to think that we are busy, or we like to think that we are, you know, important in what we're doing. How about the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? But look at his character, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That Jabir radiallahu anhu said that once we were with the Ansar, we were with the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and we are invited to a meal. So the Prophet ﷺ is walking now. And he passes by a group of children that are playing. And he sees Hassan and Hussein playing there. And what does he do? The companion said that he speeds up his walk. And he begins to go after them, to chase them. And as he's chasing them, they're running away from him, laughing. And Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he catches them. And when he catches them, the narration says that he embraces both of them, and he brings them close to him, and he kisses both of them. This is our Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. This is our example of fatherhood. This is our example of manhood. This is our example of futuah. This is our example of chivalry. And this is the example that all of us should be following. To give that time to our families, because he, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, gave time to his families. Just a short time. Because that is what is going to be remembered. We don't want to be people that are filled with regret. Right? Because that career was so important for us, but yet we neglected our family in the process. That's not the way of the Prophet ﷺ. And you see what happened through his tarbiyah, that the men who they grew up to become, radiallahu anhuma, Hassan and Hussein, because of the tarbiyah of the Prophet ﷺ. But here's a classic example of it, of giving them time, right? Giving them our attention. We'll never regret a moment of that. أَقُولُ قَوْلِ هَذَا وَاسْتَغْفِرُ لَكُمْ وَسَأَلُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ يَا قَوْمِ يَسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهَ. إن الحمد لله حمدا كثيرا كما أمر وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن سيدنا وحبيبنا مولانا سيدنا محمد عبده ورسوله عباد الله أذكركم بتقوى الله سبحانه وتعالى أذكركم بقول سيدنا محمد صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم حيث يقول اتقوا الله حيثما كنتم أذكركم بشرف مكان مصطفى صلى الله عليه وآله وصحبه وسلم حيث يقول الله سبحانه وتعالى في القرآن الكريم إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد كما صليت وباركت على سيدنا إبراهيم وعلى آل سيدنا إبراهيم إنك أنت حميد مجيد. So alhamdulillah, just a few other forms of advice and sharing that we stop again with intentionality and we look around us and contemplate the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I just read something yesterday that Darda radiallahu anha, she said about Abu Darda radiallahu anhu, that one of his most desirable forms of ibadah was tafakkur, was contemplation and reflection on the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah says in the Quran, وَفِي الْأَرْضِ آيَاتٌ لِلْمُوقِنِينَ وَفِي أَنفُسِكُمْ أَفَلَا تُبْصِرُونَ, that in the earth are the signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And when we connect ourselves with these signs, they are amazing. We had the opportunity, we hear in Sirah a lot of the connection between dates in our tradition, and we had it just now when we were in Medina, we had an opportunity to see what the birth of the date fruit looks like. And that was amazing for some of our students, to understand that cycle that comes over and over and over and over again. And then even for myself, when we were living in the Emirates, and I saw this happen when it comes out just like a small green little pebble. But then you begin to understand the story in Quran of the three who stood back when they were asked to go forth at the time of their date harvest, because their date harvest was their staple economy. And it only comes once a year. And Allah, in His infinite wisdom, sends out that this campaign should happen right at the time of their harvest. And it wasn't until I saw this transition from this little green date all the way until, as Allah mentioned, or they mentioned in this hadith, that when they were asked to go forth in this battle, that it said that the branches of the date palm were bent over because of the weight of their harvest. It wasn't until I saw this that I began to understand what the value was and what the draw was of the dunya, right? When Allah is asking us to go forth. So we begin to reflect in our signs around us, it'll give us a deeper understanding. And another thing that we should reflect upon is even just the word itself, that it's called ayat. We have ayat in the Qur'an, but we have ayat that are outside of the Qur'an as well. And just as we study these, we should also study these external ayat as well. It's the same word. May Allah give us understanding. Alhamdulillah, just in this last one here before we end, about making dua for each other in the absence of one another. Again, and I'm saying these are just things that we, just 10 minutes. Just 10. If you have to put it onto your schedule, put it onto your schedule. Give yourself an alarm. Give yourself a reminder. The whole point, though, is that it gets done. May Allah give us steadfastness, istiqamah, in these realities. So the Prophet ﷺ said that if a person prays in the absence of their brother or their sister here, this is not gender specific, that an angel is appointed to them that makes dua for them, says, وَلَكَ مِثْلُ ذَلِكَ وَلَكَ مِثْلُ ذَلِكَ. And some of the Sahaba, they took this, and it said that when they were desirous of something, that when a person makes dua for someone in their absence, oh Allah give them tawfiq, Allah ta'alayhi, right? Whenever you make dua for someone, that there's an angel that comes and says, for you, the same thing. And for you, the same thing. Some of the Sahaba said that we didn't want to make dua just for ourselves like this, so we would make dua for someone else when we wanted someone to have the assistance of an angel saying, and may you have the same. So something very brief. Making dua for someone in their absence. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us tawfiq, inshaAllah, to be people that hear these words, inshaAllah, and implement them. Allahumma arham al-mu'mineen wal-mu'minat, al-muslimin wal-muslimat, al-ahya'i minhum wal-amwati, arhamar rahimin. Allahumma ifta' alayna fathan qareeban wa binan wasi'an, fatan yuleek bikaramik wa rahmatika, ya arhamar rahimin. Allahumma arhamna fawq al-ard, wa taht al-ard, ويوم نقوم بين يديك يا رب العالمين اللهم كن معنا ولا تكن علينا عبدا يا رب العالمين اللهم أكرمنا بتلاوة كتابك آناء الليل وأطراف النهار يا رب العالمين وجعل القرآن ربيع صدورنا يا رب العالمين وشفاء صدورنا يا رب العالمين عباد الله إن الله يأمركم بالعدل وإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون وأقيم الصلاة يرحمني يرحمكم الله.